Magandang araw sa inyong lahat and welcome to our first pre-recorded lecture for the subject CP102A, Care of the High-Risk Newborn to Maturity. I am Dr. Jeff Leire Boron and I will be your instructor for the said subject. Please bring out your handouts so that we can continue with our lesson for this video. Now, before we dive any deeper to our discussion about the lesson, let us look first at the importance of the subject, why you need to learn about the care of the high-risk newborn to maturity. Now, as a midwife, you should learn how to take care of a well child as well as the ill ones or the ones who have significant variations in gestational age or weight. Last semester, you were taught how to properly care for neonates or newborns with no problems, but it is also your responsibility to be able to take care of neonates or newborns with present problems that are related to gestational age or weight. And when you learn to recognize these infants at birth, the ones who are problematic when it comes to their present condition, you start to gain a knowledge or working skills to care for them, which will also help you become better midwives later on in your career. So that is the importance why we need to learn about these topics. Now let us also look at the different risk factors that can potentially lead to illnesses in a newborn or yung mga pwedeng dahilan kung bakit tayo nagkakaroon ng mga problematic or ill neonates during delivery. Number one dyan is that there is younger or older than average maternal age when they get pregnant. Yung mga nanay na nagiging buntis who are younger than 18 years old or who are older than 35 years old, that means that their pregnancy may lead to a problematic neonate or newborn. Kasi ang ating pinakamaganda or pinaka-appropriate na age of pregnancy is 18 to 35 years old. Younger than that or older than that is magiging problematic yung outcome ng ating pregnancy. Aside from that, when a mother has disease conditions like diabetes and HIV, or like for example diabetes, HIV, or pregnancy-induced hypertension, these conditions may also affect the child, the growing fetus. In turn, when that fetus gets delivered and becomes a neonate, nagkakaroon din siya ng problematic conditions on the lungs. So maaaring ito din yung mga risk factors kung bakit tayo nagkakaroon ng problematic babies or neonates. Aside from that, when there is also presence of pregnancy complications such as placenta previa or yung placenta is nasa maling place, or what we call we also have abruptio placenta wherein there is premature separation of the placenta from the uterus, kung yung nanay ay may mga ganoong pregnancy complications, you can also expect that the newborn will also have problems when they get delivered. Now, aside from those mentioned, maaari din tayong magkaroon ng problematic neonates or newborns if the mother has unhealthy maternal lifestyle. Kunwari, yung nanay ay hindi kumakain ng masusustansyang pagkain during pregnancy. Or if the mother is using drugs, or si mother ay drug addict, or nagkakaroon siya ng alcohol consumption during pregnancy. Or if the mother is a smoker, that can also lead to a problematic neonate after delivery. Aside from that, maaari din itong dahilan ng problematic newborns natin or neonates is because of dismature infants. This means that some infants can be born before term or what we call preterm, or meron ding mga pinapanganak after their term or what we call post-term. Or a child is underweight or overweight. Yung mga factors na yon can also lead to problematic neonates. Mag-aaring magkaroon tayo ng problema taking care of these neonates during their delivery kung meron silang ganitong risk factors. Now, you always have to remember that being able to predict that an infant is high risk will allow advanced preparation so that specialized and skilled healthcare personnel can be present during the child's birth. Now, kung alam mo yung mga risk factors na ito, and that you are able to predict that the neonate will have problems initiating respiration or when it comes to circulation, kung alam mo yung mga risk factors na ito, nakita mo ito sa inyong pregnant client, and you automatically think, naku, baka magkaroon ako ng problematic neonates during the delivery. So kung alam mo yung mga different risk factors that may lead to illnesses in a newborn, you as a midwife will be able to anticipate or prepare for the worst. So what do? You are already able to prepare yourself and create a team of specialized and skilled healthcare personnel that can be present at the child's birth to give resuscitation, because you know for a fact that the child will have problems regarding their health condition. So, bakit natin kailangang i-predict na magkakaroon tayo ng problematic newborns? Because we want to create a team and anticipate the service that we provide na magbibigay tayo ng interventions that can save the lives of the baby. As what was discussed last semester, we also have different newborn priorities in the first days of life. And number one po dyan na priority natin as midwives is to initiate and maintain respirations. And aside from that, we also have to establish extrauterine circulation. Aside from that, we should also do thermoregulation or control of the body temperature of the neonate, and also facilitate or initiate the intake of adequate nourishment, or starting na po ng ating breastfeeding or bottle feeding to our newborns. Aside from that, we should also establish proper waste elimination, including the passage of fetus and urination. And we also have to prevent possible infection in the high risk or ill neonates. Aside from that, we also have to establish their parent and child relationship, along with the developmental care and physiologic stimulation of the ill neonate. So you have to remember po na when we are taking care of well newborns, meron tayong mga different priorities. And when we are taking care of ill newborns, we also have different priorities. And basically, these are the things that we need to observe when taking care of ill neonates. Now let us look at the initiation and maintenance of respiration. Ano yung mga roles natin as midwives when it comes to initiating and maintaining the respiration of the ill neonate or the problematic neonate? Now, you have to remember that most deaths occur during the first 48 hours after birth. So yung first 2 days po ng bata, ng ill neonate, dyan po nagkakaroon usually ng death from the newborn's inability to initiate and maintain respirations. That means, nakaramihan po sa mga namamatay natin na mga neonates na pasyente is that they have the inability to initiate or maintain respiration. Nahihirapan silang mag-start na huminga at nahihirapan nilang i-maintain yung respiratory pattern nila na yon. So basically, these neonates die on the first 48 hours or the first 2 days of life because of their inability to initiate and maintain respiration. Kaya nga po, yung priority natin is that we have to help the neonate start or initiate respiration and also maintain that respiration as much as possible. Now, an infant who has difficulty initiating effective breathing on the first hours of life, yung mga bata daw na or mga neonates daw na nahirapan na huminga on the first hours of life may experience neurologic dysfunctions because of cerebral hypoxia. Now, ang nangyayari kasi is that when there is low level of oxygen in the body, or kung yung bata nahihirapang huminga, ibig sabihin nagkakaroon siya ng hypoxia. Bumababa yung kanyang level of oxygen. Now what happens is that there is also low level of oxygen going to the brain of the child. Konti lang po yung pumuputang oxygen sa utak ng bata kasi nga po nahihirapan na po siyang huminga. And what happens? Some of your brain cells die because of cerebral hypoxia. So ang nangyayari, yung mga bata po, paglaki niyan, nagkakaroon sila ng neurologic dysfunctions. Kaya nga po, karamihan sa tinatawag nilang blue baby or yung mga cyanotic on their first hours of life, they tend to have a permanent brain damage. Nagkakaroon sila ng neurologic dysfunctions or mental retardation. Kumapkapoy da as compared to other people world when it comes to their cognitive processes or thinking dahil po sa cerebral hypoxia. So again, it is very important that we establish respiration as much as possible so that we prevent neurologic dysfunctions in our patients. Aside from that, newborns who are not able to establish respiration within the first 2 minutes of life will also likely develop respiratory acidosis. Ano po ang nangyayari kasi? Di ba po mababa yung ating oxygen level because of the inability to initiate respiration? Ang nangyayari po kasi sa atin is that when our body uses aerobic metabolism, so ang nangyayari is that we use oxygen to break down our fats and then convert it into energy. So kailangan po ng ating katawan ng oxygen to break down the fats and to produce energy. Kaya nga po siya tinawag na aerobic metabolism. However, kung yung bata po ay nahihirapang huminga, our body will need energy. Kunadanton, I need oxygen so that I can convert or produce energy. Ang problema yung bata hindi nakakahinga, kaya mababa yung level of oxygen in our body. So what will the body do? It will shift from aerobic respiration to anaerobic respiration, meaning yung katawan natin magproproduce na siya ng energy even without the use of oxygen. So what will the body do? It will force itself to create energy kahit na walang oxygen. And what will happen? There will be production of lactic acid. Ito yung end product po kasi ng anaerobic respiration. Nakaka-create yung katawan mo ng energy kahit walang oxygen, but ang problem po is that nagkakaroon din siya ng lactic acid production. Nagproproduce yung katawan natin ng lactic acid. At pag na-imbak or dumami yung lactic acid na yon, it now causes metabolic and respiratory acidosis. Now, aside from that, it can also be caused by asphyxia in utero. Okay? Maaaring yung ating problem is caused by the lack of oxygen while the fetus is still inside the womb of the mother. Paano nagkakaroon ng ganun? It may be due to cord compression or yung cord kung saan dumadaan yung dugo na compress kaya walang masyadong pumapasok na blood and oxygen to the baby. Or it can also be caused by maternal anesthesia or placenta previa or abruptio placenta. Now, all of these may also lead to respiratory acidosis kasi meron pong hypoxia or low level of energy, low level of oxygen na pumupunta kay baby pag meron cord compression, there is maternal anesthesia, placenta previa, and abruptio placenta. So these po are the reasons why we need to initiate and maintain respiration in the baby. Number one is to prevent death on the first 2 days of life. Aside from that, to prevent neurologic dysfunction. Aside from that, we also want to prevent respiratory acidosis. And lastly, is we also want to prevent metabolic acidosis. So yun po yung mga reasons why we need to initiate and maintain respiration. Now, we have already established the importance of initiating breathing. Alam na po natin na sobrang importante na dapat yung bata, after delivery, they immediately breathe. Now, meron po kasing mga dangers of delayed breathing. May mga problema po tayo pag yung bata na de-delay yung kanyang paghinga. We have to remember that if breathing is ineffective, kung hindi po maganda yung paghinga ng bata, circulation is also affected. Even the circulation of the blood in the different parts of the body can also have a direct effect if there is delayed breathing. Now, isa sa mga dangers ng ating delayed breathing is that the ductus arteriosus will fail to close. Kung naaalala nyo pa po yung ating circulatory system of specifically the fetal circulation, meron po tayong mga fetal accessory structures na makikita natin sa fetal circulation that will eventually close or maglalaho po yan once the newborn is already out of the uterus. Itong mga fetal accessory structures natin in circulation include the ductus arteriosus, which connects the pulmonary artery and the aorta. Now, like I said a while ago, magko-close dapat po yung ductus arteriosus once respiration has already been established. Now, because of increased pressure on the left side of the heart, blood circulation may become ineffective po. In your patent ductus arteriosus, pag hindi po natin agad na pahinga yung bata, diji ubinghan suna insigida nga nakaanges, this ductus arteriosus will not close, meaning it will remain open. What happens is that there will be mixing of the blood, oxygenated blood, with the unoxygenated blood. Ito po yung isang condition na in Ilocano tinatawag nilang at the abut gaminji puso na isong agkol color blue deje ubing tagamin marigatan nga ag-circulate deje antidara. That's because of the ductus arteriosus. Maiiwasan po natin yon if we immediately initiate breathing to the child after delivery. So ito po yung isang danger of delayed breathing, that the ductus arteriosus will fail to close if we do not initiate breathing immediately. Now, because of poor circulation and struggling to breathe, the infant can also use serum glucose quickly. Dahil nga sa nahihirapan yung bata na huminga, mapipilitan siyang gamitin yung kanyang glucose in the body. You have to remember po, no, that the glucose is also considered one of the fuels of the body. Ito po yung ginagamit ng ating katawan para mag-create po ng energy. For example, ikaw po ay tumatakbo sa marathon. So anong ginagawa natin? Minsan pinapainom natin sila ng Coke kasi marami yung glucose, or pinagtetake natin sila ng candy, or nagka-carbo-loading sila kasi yung mga carbohydrates po, they are rich in glucose kasi the body uses these glucose to convert it into energy. Now yung bata kasi, since nahihirapan siyang huminga, niya marigatan nga ganges, ang nangyayari is that the child is exerting so much effort sa kanyang paghinga na dahil sa sobrang dami niyang effort na yon, nauubos yung kanyang fuel or gasolina in the form of glucose. So what happens? Nagkakaroon po yung ating neonate ng hypoglycemia, which also will add up to the problem again. So makita nyo, no, pag yung bata po is nahihirapang huminga, aside from the fact na hindi magko-close yung kanyang ductus arteriosus dahil sa sobra niyang pag-effort na paghinga, ang mangyayari is mauubos niya yung kanyang glucose stores, which will now lead to hypoglycemia, which will again lead to the aggravation of the problem. Now, ano-ano ba kasi yung mga possible na reasons or factors kung bakit nagkakaroon ng respiratory difficulty or nahihirapang huminga yung bata after delivery? Now, you have to remember that majority of low birth weight infants, yung mga mas magaan pa sa normal, which is less than 2.5 kilograms at birth, kasi ang normal po natin is 2.5 to 4 kilos. Yung mga low birth weight neonates natin, they are typically the ones who have problems initiating respiration. Aside from that, if the mother has maternal history of diabetes, or yung nanay na buntis ay meron siyang diabetes, you can expect that the child will also have difficulty of breathing. Isa yun sa mga factors that predispose respiratory problems. Aside from that, if there is premature rupture of membranes, or yung bag of water, or in Ilocano yung sinusuon is nasapang nabtak. Okay, there is premature rupture of the bag of water or the amniotic membrane or amniotic sac. No, nasapa nga nabtak dejay, nabtakanti sinusoon, you can expect that the child will also have respiratory difficulty after their delivery. Aside from that, if the mother is a drug addict or if the mother uses certain types of drugs, that can also affect the ability of the child to start breathing. So nga marigatan tumit nga aganges deje ubing if the mother is using narcotics. Another predisposing factor that may lead to respiratory difficulty is meconium staining. So yung bata po, pag nakatae siya sa loob ng matres ng nanay, the problem is that the meconium can mix with the amniotic fluid. And this amniotic fluid that is contaminated by the meconium may lodge onto the lungs of the child. Kasi nga po, nilulunok po ng bata yung amniotic fluid na yon. And if that contains meconium, maaaring magbara po yung ating meconium sa lungs ng bata, which will also lead to respiratory difficulty. Because you know very well that meconium is a foreign substance that when it goes to the lungs, it creates or it causes inflammation of the lungs. So yan po yung isang problema natin if there is meconium staining. There will be possible respiratory difficulty. Aside from that is possible cord prolapse. Pag yung cord prolapse naman po is nauunang lumabas yung umbilical cord. Pag nauunang lumabas yung umbilical cord, you can also expect that the child will also have signs of respiratory difficulty pag meron siyang cord prolapse. Aside from that, we also typically see respiratory problems or difficulty initiating breathing in children with Apgar scores that are lower than 7 at the first minute and the fifth minute of life. Kung naaalala nyo pa po yung ating Apgar score, 1 to 3 means that the child is in serious danger. Pag 4 to 6 po, it means that the child's condition is guarded. But if the child is 7 to 10, ibig sabihin the child's condition is good. Now, pag yung bata po or yung neonate natin, they have an Apgar score that is less than 7. So, 6 below po siya. On the first minute of life and the fifth minute of life, that means that there is a possibility na meron silang respiratory difficulty, kaya ganun po yung kanilang Apgar score. Aside from that, if the child is also post-mature or masyado siyang matagal na nagstay inside the womb of the mother, more than 42 weeks of gestation or mas matagal pa sa 9 months, sa pananatili ng bata sa loob ng matres, that's post-maturity, that means that the child also has a possibility of having respiratory difficulty. Aside from that, like as mentioned a while ago, yung mga small for gestational age infants or neonates, yung mga maliliit, less than 2.5 grams at birth sila, they also have respiratory difficulty as expected. Or yung mga pinanganak po na breech, nauuna yung puwet or paa, instead of ulo yung nauuna during vaginal delivery, they also have the possibility of initiating breathing. Mahihirapan din po silang huminga pag sila ay breech presentation. Aside from that, there's also a possibility of respiratory problems pag pinanganak na merong kambal or triplets or multiple births ang tawag natin doon, that may also lead to respiratory difficulty. Aside from that, we also expect presence of respiratory difficulty in neonates who had fetal distress or yung mga bata po na ang kanilang FHT ay less than 120 beats per minute or more than 160 beats per minute. So those are what we call fetal distress. Pag mas mababa sa 120 or mas mataas sa 160 beats per minute yung kanyang fetal heart tone, that means that when the child gets delivered, they will also have respiratory difficulty. Or kung yung bata po ay meron siyang known abnormality or congenital anomalies in the chest, in the heart, or in the respiratory tract, you can also expect that they will show signs and symptoms of respiratory difficulty and the problems in initiating breathing. Now, if we come in contact with these kinds of patients na mayroong factors that may lead to respiratory difficulty, ano po yung mga minention natin kanina? Pag alam mo that that patient has predisposing factors that may lead to the neonate to have respiratory difficulty, it is important that we, midwives and healthcare providers, should be able to anticipate the needs of that patient. Dapat po alam natin kung ano yung mga gagawin or kakailanganin ng bata pag meron na itong predisposing factors that may lead to respiratory difficulty, so that pag tayo ay pupunta po sa delivery room, dapat po prepared na po tayo to take care of these patients who are high risk of having respiratory difficulty. So dapat i-prepare na po natin yung team, yung mga gagamitin natin for neonatal resuscitation. Now when we speak of neonatal resuscitation, it is defined as the administration of emergency measures to support the newborn's adaptation to the extrauterine life. Anong ibig sabihin nito? We have to prepare ourselves and our equipment so that we can give the necessary midwifery interventions para po maligtas natin yung bata from respiratory difficulty. Alright, so meron po tayong tinatawag na neonatal resuscitation to help the child transition from intrauterine life to extrauterine adaptation. So ano pong gagawin natin in the resuscitation process? Number one is before the delivery of the child, when the mother is still inside the delivery room at yung bata po ay hindi pa inailalabas ng nanay, at alam natin that there are different factors that they may lead to respiratory difficulty, we have to already prepare our equipment before birth and to test its functioning. Aside from the fact na dapat hawak-hawak na natin yung mga equipment or materials natin na kailangan for resuscitation, we also have to test if these are really functioning. Baka ket di ag malfunction dejay during the time that we already need this equipment, at yun pa yung maging dahilan kung bakit tayo mamamatayan ng patient. So you have to test for the functioning of this equipment, specifically yung mga resuscitation bags natin, suction apparatus, or yung mga oxygen cannula na gagamitin natin. We have to make sure that they're functioning before the delivery of the neonate. Aside from that, we also have blankets or clean towels so that we can dry the child. Diba nga po, kailangan nating i-thermoregulate yung bata. So we have to dry the child with the blanket and place the child in a radiant warmer. Kasi ang isang pong problema natin sa mga neonates is that they have the inability to thermoregulate themselves. So dapat tanggalin muna natin yung mga amniotic fluid para po hindi ginawin yung bata. We have to keep the baby dry and warm by placing the child in a radiant warmer and also wiping the excess amniotic fluid in their skin para po hindi sila magkaroon ng hypothermia. Aside from that, we establish and maintain the airway. Paano natin i-maintain and i-establish yung airway? We have to position the neck that is slightly extended. Now, paano natin po i-extend yung neck ng bata? We have to place a rolled blanket under the shoulders of the child. So, pag ilalagay natin yung rolled blanket po dito sa ating likod ng bata, nag-extend po yung neck automatically. So that is how we establish and maintain a patent airway, by extending the neck of the child and placing a rolled blanket under their shoulder. Aside from that, we also have to clean the airway and make sure na wala pong bara doon sa ating mouth and nose. So how do we do that? How do we clear the airway? By suctioning the mouth and then the nose of the child with a bulb aspirator. Remember po ano, na nauuna na isinasuction natin yung mouth before the nose using the bulb aspirator to prevent reflex gasping. Ayaw natin po na mag-gasp yung bata. Kasano mapaspasamak dito reflex gasping? If you suction the nose, ang mangyayari po is matitrigger yung bata na mag-gasp siya. Kanana. So ngano inyunam nga sinaksyon deto, kunwari meron tayong secretions on the mouth, may secretions tayo sa nose. Alam natin na pag sinasaksyon yung nose, nagagasp yung patient. Kunana. So pag una mong sinaksyon yung ilong na meron pang secretions on the mouth, maa-aspirate po ng pasyente yung secretions on the mouth. But, like I said, if you suction the mouth first, Before suctioning the nose, sige, inikat mo nga rin secretions in the mouth niya. Sinaction mo dyan agong. Nag-gasp di ubing. Kuna na. Meron ba siyang na-aspirate? Wala na po. Because you suction the mouth before the nose. That's the reason why. Nauuna dapat yung bibig na sinasuction kesa sa ilong. Aside from that, we also have to use tactile stimulation to stimulate the newborn to cry. Because breathing, ang surest sign of breathing po is crying. So how do we do tactile stimulation? By rubbing the back of the neonate. Yun po yung gagamitin natin para umiyak yung bata. Gone are the days na pinapalo pa natin yung bata para lang siya umiyak. The best way to stimulate crying and to stimulate breathing is through tactile stimulation by rubbing the back of the neonate. In case that our patient, our neonate, is meconium stained, we also have to intubate the child to remove meconium. Kasi nga po problema natin pag yung meconium nakapasok sa lungs ng bata is that it will lead to inflammation of the lung tissue. So what do? The doctors will have to intubate or insert a tube on the mouth of the child, and then we will have to do deep tracheal suctioning to remove the meconium, and we repeat the process of suctioning until the return is clear, until sa wala na po tayong masuction na meconium. We again, like I said, we want to remove all meconium that is lodged on the bronchioles of the child so that we can prevent inflammation of the lung tissues. Kasi yun pong meconium na yun, that can lead to secondary pneumonia. Now, aside from those mentioned, we also have to place the child in intubation. So, magdi-deep tracheal suctioning tayo. We will intubate the child to remove the excess meconium that has lodged on the bronchioles of the child. And we will repeat the process until the return is clear. So, gusto nyo po natin tanggalin lahat ng mga meconium na na-aspirate or na-swallow ng ating neonate, because as you know that the presence of the meconium can be the cause of the inflammation of the lungs. Thereby, it can also lead to respiratory difficulty of the newborn. So, kailangan nating tanggalin yon through deep tracheal suctioning. Aside from that, we also have to monitor the heart rate or the cardiac rate of our patient along with their respiratory effort. You have to remember that a heart rate less than 80 beats per minute is already problematic, and the heart rate and the respiratory rate, I should say, that is more than 60 breaths or cycles per minute is also problematic for our neonate. Now, during resuscitation, we also have to expand the lungs. And how do we help the newborn initiate breathing or expand the lungs? By using proper fitting and sealed resuscitation bags, or what we call AMBA bags, with 100% of oxygen at 40 to 60 cycles per minute until the newborn's color becomes pink. So, ibig sabihin nito, magbibigay po tayo ng rescue breathing sa ating mga pasyente by giving them proper fitting and sealed resuscitation bags, yung AMBO bag na pinapump natin para magbigay ng 100% oxygen sa lungs ng ating patient. Now, we have to do this until the cyanosis goes away and until the newborn's color has already become pink. Aside from that, we also have to administer chest compressions of less than 80 beats per minute until the infant's heart rate is more than 80 beats per minute already. Kaya nga po kailangan nating i-monitor yung heart rate and yung respiration ng ating problematic na neonate so that we know if it is necessary for us to give AMBO bagging or necessary ba magbigay tayo ng chest compression. So, kung yung kanyang heart rate is less than 80 beats per minute, dapat magbigay po tayo ng cardiac compression until the heart rate is already more than 80 beats per minute. Kung yung pasyente naman is hindi umihinga, dun naman po tayo mag-expand the lungs by using proper fitting and sealed resuscitation bags with 100% oxygen at 40 to 60 cycles per minute until the newborn's color become pink. Aside from that, we should also auscultate both the lung fields. Gusto nating pakinggan yung ating breath sounds to know if both lungs are aerated. Kasi may mga ibang pasyente tayo na parang okay naman yung kanilang paghinga, only to find out that one lung has already collapsed while the other is okay. So dapat po, chine-check din natin if both lungs are properly aerated. So you should auscultate the breath sounds on both lung fields. Aside from that, you also have to secure the airway or keep the airway patent or open or clear, and you also have to administer the drugs as ordered by the physician. Now, you have to remember that if respiratory depression becomes severe, hindi halos makahinga yung pasyente, a newborn's heart may start to fail. Maaaring ito po yung maging cause ng ating cardiac arrest kung yung kanyang respiratory depression ay sobrang malala. Now, what do you need to do? You should increase or include cardiac massage in the resuscitation. Kung kailangan nating maggaganon, i-cardiac massage natin yung pasyente kung meron siyang respiratory depression so that we can prevent heart failure. It is also our responsibility as midwives to clear the airway of this neonate. So kailangan nating tanggalin lahat ng mga secretions that are lodged on the airway of our patients. Now, the term newborns or yung mga newborns na na sakto sa kanilang buwan, okay, term newborns or those who are born from 38 weeks of gestation until 42 weeks of gestation, the use of bulb aspirator to remove the mucus and to prevent aspiration during initiation of breath is already enough to establish a clear airway. Pwedeng bulb aspirator lang po yung gamitin natin to remove the mucus that are lodged on the airway of our patient. And when we remove that, we are already able to establish a clear airway. Yon po yung lagi nyong tatandaan, enough na po yung ginagamit natin na bulb aspirator. Now, if the infant is hard up in initiating the first breath, kunwari nahirapan siyang i-initiate or start yung kanyang breathing, we have to suction the mouth and the nose again using the bulb aspirator, and we can also rub the back of the newborn for tactile stimulation or to stimulate the newborn to cry. Yun po yung mga pwede nating gawin if our patient is a term newborn. Okay? Now, aside from that, we also have to start drying the newborn to prevent chilling. Okay? So, bakit po natin kailangang i-dry yung newborn to prevent chilling? You have to remember that if the body tries to raise the temperature, no, ang mangyayari kasi pag yung katawan natin nilalamig, mag-chills tayo, agpiger-ger tayo. Bakit kailangan ng katawan natin gamin yung movement na to? Because that movement will trigger heat production. Okay? Now, pag gagawin yun ng ating katawan, the more din po na oxygen ang kanyang isispend to create more energy. Now, if the infant or the neonate is unable to supply the needed oxygen for chilling to create energy, since breathing has not been initiated, ang mangyayari po, mas magkakaroon tayo ng metabolic and respiratory acidosis. Kasi nga po, makukulangan tayo ng oxygen pag tayo ay nagpo-produce pa ng energy using the chills, yung mga movement natin na ganito. So we have to dry the newborn to prevent chilling para po hindi ma-aggravate yung kanyang lack of oxygen because of energy expenditure due to raising the temperature. Okay? Now, you also have to watch out for meconium-stained babies. Lalo tayong magbibigay dapat ng pansin sa mga pasyente natin who are meconium-stained when it comes to clearing their airway. You have to remember po na we should not rub the back of the patients who are meconium-stained because we don't want them to cry. Bakit po? Because if we We let the patients cry na sila ay may conium stained. Mas sila ay mag-aaspirate. Okay, no, agsangit da, adadati masuloy da nga may conium, ang mangyayari is that it will aggravate the situation. We also have to remember to not give oxygen using high pressure. Kasi pag malakas po yung pressure na ibibigay natin using the nasal cannula, ang mangyayari is that the meconium that are lodged on the mouth and the nose of the patient will be pushed down further in the newborn's airway. So, instead nagagamit po tayo ng oxygen cannula, gagamit po tayo ng oxygen mask without pressure, and we also have to intubate the baby for deep tracheal suctioning. Again, always remember po, pag yung pasyente nyo ay meconium stained, do not rub the back of the baby and stimulate the baby to cry. Kasi the more na mag-iiyak yan, the more na makakaswallow yan ng meconium, the more po tayong magkaka-problema. You also have to not give oxygen in a very high pressure kasi ipupush ng high pressure oxygen yung meconium pababa. Mas mahihirapan po tayo pag nangyari yon. Instead, what do? We give oxygen mask without pressure and we intubate the baby for deep tracheal suctioning. Now, when it comes to clearing the airway, meron po tayong tinatawag na primary apnea. The primary apnea is seen on the first seconds of life in a severely depressed newborn. And the newborn will take several weak gasps of air. So, gaganun siya. Followed immediately by an apnea. So, maggagasp siya for air a few times and then hindi na po siya hihinga. And at that moment na hindi po siya humihinga, the heart rate will already start to fall. So, pag yung heart rate niya, ganun dapat, bababa na po yan, magiging less than 80 beats per minute na po din yan if that primary apnea occurs. Now, pag nakita nyo po yung primary apnea sa ating pasyente, kunwari on the first seconds of life, magga-gasp for air siya, and then hindi na po siya hihinga, yun yung tinatawag natin na primary apnea. If you see that in your patient, if the newborn already enters this state, we should already start doing resuscitation. Because if we do resuscitation during these periods, those resuscitation attempts are generally successful. Mabubuhay po natin yung patient pag ginawa natin yung resuscitation as early as primary apnea. Pag nakita natin yung primary apnea, dapat automatic na mag-resuscitate na po tayo because the resuscitation attempts at this time are generally successful. Now, meron din kasi tayong tinatawag na secondary apnea. And when we speak of secondary apnea, it happens on the first 2 minutes after the primary apnea. Okay? So, di ba yung pasyente natin sa primary apnea, magagasp, aganges, and then hangagangisen. Okay? Meron siyang apnea. After that, yung pasyente natin, after 2 minutes of apnea, ang mangyayari, the infant will again try to initiate respiration, pero this time, strong gasp naman po yung kanyang gagawin. Kasla ko madiginal mess nga pasyente, nga nabayag nga hanggang makaagis, and then no, makalungawin kay... kakasiti pinagangis na, that is what we call the secondary apnea. Now, you have to remember that when a patient takes strong gasp, no nauunig, DJ pinagangis na, that child cannot maintain that effort for more than 4 to 5 minutes. Kung gagawin niya yon ng diretso for 4 to 5 minutes, mapapagod po siya. And the respiratory effort of the child will become weaker and weaker and weaker, and then their heart rate will also start to fall further and further and further until the infant stops gasping, and then the infant will already eventually die. So mamamatay na po siya after that. Now, you have to remember that when you do resuscitation measures sa secondary apnea po, it may already be ineffective. Ibig sabihin, too late na po yung ating resuscitation if you only start resuscitation measures during the secondary apnea. So what do? Always start resuscitation as if secondary apnea is already occurring. So pagkakita mo pa lang po na hindi na humihinga yung pasyente, agad-agad magbigay ka na ng resuscitation measures. Kasi pag hinintay mo pa yan na mag-secondary apnea yung pasyente natin, your resuscitation measures may already be difficult and may be ineffective. So laging tatandaan, pag primary apnea, weak gasp followed by a period of apnea or no breathing. Sa secondary apnea naman, magsa-start po siya ng no breathing for 1 to 2 minutes and then strong gasping of air until sa hihina ng hihina yung kanyang respiration and cardiac rate until such time na magfo-fall na yung kanyang vital signs. Alright? So, pinakamaganda na gawin yung resuscitation measures is during primary apnea. And usually, pag secondary apnea po gagawin yung resuscitation measures, it's already ineffective. Now, kunwari po, naging successful tayo when it comes to resuscitating our newborn. Okay, kunwari, nagawa natin, na-establish natin yung respiration. The next thing that we need to do is to promote lung expansion. I-expand naman natin yung lungs ng ating patient. Okay. Now, once an airway is already established, natanggal mo po yung mga secretions or natanggal mo yung mga meconium, and then also you have already established the initial breath of the patient, the newborn's lung should already be expanded during that time. Now, for term newborns or yung mga newborns na pinanganak from 37 weeks of gestation until 42 weeks of gestation, they are able to inflate their lungs adequately with the first breath. So, damo pa ilaig nga pinag-angis da, na-inflate dan or na-expand dan de lungs da properly. And a sound of baby crying is a proof of a good lung expansion. So, pag yung bata po umiiyak, ibig sabihin that the lungs are already properly expanded because crying is the surest sign of breathing. Now, if the newborn is breathing spontaneously, agang anges met deji newborn, but they cannot sustain effective respiration, agang anges dang, im color blue damit lata, parang hindi maganda yung kanilang respiration, what do? We give oxygen via face mask to aid in the lung expansion, and we give it at a rate of 40 to 60 cycles per minute. Apay-apo nga 40 to 60 cycles per minute because that is the normal respiratory rate of the neonate. Okay? Now, we should also always watch out for the use of the oxygen mask. Okay? The oxygen mask should cover both the nose and the mouth of the patient. So, dapat covered yung bunganga at ilong for oxygen administration to be effective. Kasi kung yung mouth lang yung covered, hindi naman nakakapasok yung oxygen sa ilong. So, useless lang din. Mas kokonti lang yung oxygen concentration na pumapasok. So, it should cover both mouth and the nose, and it should not also cover the eyes. Kasi pag kinakover mo yung eyes ng pasyente using the oxygen mask, it can cause mechanical eye damage because of the drying of the cornea. So as much as possible po, you use a proper fitting oxygen masks to our patient. Pag yung pasyente nyo po ay pedia, edi pedia oxygen mask po yung gagamitin. Kasi pag adult, baka buong mukha po yung matakpan sa ating patient, and that can also lead to mechanical blindness because of the drying of the cornea. Aside from that, you also have to prevent cooling and drying of the nasal mucosa. So, na-try nyo naman po siguro pag masyadong malamig yung room at pag humihinga kayo, na hindi humidified properly or walang moisture yung ating air na ini-inhale, ang nangyayari is that it dries our mucosa. Mas mahirap pong huminga pag ganon. So, as much as possible, you have to control the temperature of the room and make sure that it is at least 32 to 34 degrees Celsius para po hindi mahirapang huminga yung pasyente natin, and that it is not cooling the mucosa too much and it's not drying the mucosa too much, and also that the air should be 60 to 80% humidified. So, pag nakikita po natin yung nilalagay natin sa oxygen apparatus natin, yung parang bumubula-bula doon na sinusubmerge sa tubig. Okay? Yun po yung tinatawag natin na humidifier. Ano po ang silbi ng humidifier? It adds moisture to the oxygen that we are giving to our patients so that the nasal mucosa will not dry up kasi meron siyang moisture. Now, kasi pag dry yung mucosa, mas mahirap po ang huminga para sa ating mga pasyente. Now, you also have to make sure that the oxygen levels do not fluctuate. Ang ibig sabihin ng fluctuation, ngumato bumaba, make sure po na constant yung kanyang oxygen pressure. Kung ano yung sinabi na ni doctor na oxygen level, kunwari 4 liters per minute or 3 liters per minute, yun lang dapat yung regulation na ibibigay natin sa ating mga pasyente. Bakit? If we give super strong oxygen pressure to our patients, kunwari more than what the doctor ordered, ang mangyayari is because of that strong pressure, they may be immature cranial nerves na pwedeng mag-bleeding, okay? So pwede pong magkaroon ng mga small rupture of the capillaries in the brain at maaaring magkaroon yan ng or mag-cause yan ng immature cranial nerve damage or bleeding, okay? So like I said, do not administer oxygen pressure above what is necessary. Kung ano lang yung sinabi ng doctor, yun lang po yung ibibigay natin na regulation ng ating oxygen. Because this may also cause the rupture of the lung alveoli. Pwede pong po sumabog yung mga small units ng ating lungs because of a strong pressure of oxygen. Now, aside from that, you also make sure that you auscultate both lungs. Pakinggan mo yung both lung fields natin to make sure that both sides of the chest are aerated. Baka yung isang lungs, okay naman yung expansion, habang yung isa naman, collapse na pala so that you can report immediately to the doctor if this happens. Again, you have to auscultate both lung fields to make sure that both lungs are aerated. Now, in the event po that the respiratory depression is caused by the use of a certain drug in a patient, di ba po sinabi natin kanina that the use of narcotics or drugs of a pregnant patient can lead to respiratory depression of the neonate. Now, kunwari, ito po yung reason kung bakit merong respiratory depression yung inyong mga patients. Kunwari, drug addict yung pasyente or gumamit po siya ng, kunwari, meperidine or demerol or kunwari, gumamit siya ng morphine, which are narcotic analgesics that are also known to cause difficulty of breathing or respiratory depression in neonates. Ano naman yung gagawin natin? We can give narcotic antagonist. Bibigyan natin ng narcotic antagonist yung ating pasyente para pumatanggal yung kanyang respiratory depression. Again, may mga respiratory depression po kasi that are caused by narcotics use, specifically narcotic analgesics. So kung ito po yung cause ng respiratory depression, ang ibibigay po natin ay narcotic antagonist para mawala yung respiratory depression. Now, marahil nagtataka kayo kung bakit gagamit ng morphine yung pasyente or gagamit sila ng meperidine during delivery. Now, both morphine and meperidine po kasi are used to relieve pain, particularly during childbirth. May mga ibang pasyente po kasi na mababa yung pain tolerance. Ayaw nilang masaktan or ma-feel yung kanilang labor pains, kaya magre-request sila ng painless delivery. So gagamit si doctor ng morphine or gagamit si doctor ng meperidine, i-inject niya to sa pasyente na manganganak para hindi niya ma-feel yung pain. However, there is a possibility that this morphine and this meperidine may also go to the patient or to the infant, or to the neonate, I should say, mapasa ng nanay yung gamot to the placenta going to the baby. So anong mangyayari? Paglabas yung patient, yung bata, yung baby, marami din siyang drugs sa katawan. And ano yung mafe-feel niya? Meron siyang respiratory depression. So anong gagawin natin? We should give naloxone or Narcan. This is the drug of choice because this is a narcotic antagonist. So it will remove the effects of the narcotic analgesics like morphine or meperidine. So, ano yung gagawin ng naloxone when we give it to our neonate? It will reverse the effects of respiratory depression. And it is also administered parenterally. Pwedeng i-inject natin sa ating pasyente using the umbilical vessel. So, pwedeng gamitin po yung umbilical vein. Or we can also use the intramuscular or muscles using the vastus lateralis or the thigh muscle when nudege lupona. We can also inject that to our patient, yung ating naloxone or Narcan, to counteract the effects of meperidine or morphine. Kunwari naman po, our patient has so much bronchial secretions. So, suction po kayo ng suction, pero ang dami pa rin pong lumalabas na secretion from our patients. Maybe it's time to use atropine already. Now, atropine reduces the secretions in the mouth and the nose. Okay, specifically the respiratory passages. And it also relieves constriction and spasm of the respiratory passage. So, nung ibig sabihin nito, it helps the clearing of the airway. Okay, so pag maramit po tayong secretion sa ating pasyente, we can give atropine for our patients because it also reduces possible apnea. So yun po yung mga pwede nating ibigay sa ating pasyente. Now, we can also give calcium chloride as per doctor's order. Yung calcium chloride naman po, it increases heart contractility. Kunwari po yung heart rate ng ating pasyente na neonate ay sobrang hina at sobrang bagal ng kanyang cardiac rate or heart rate, we can give calcium chloride because it helps to prevent cardiac arrhythmia and it also increases the heart contractility. Pinapaganda niya yung quality and quantity ng pagpitik ng puso. So that's calcium chloride. We can also give dopamine in patients, in pediatric patients with very low BP. So kunwari yung pedia patient mo, mababa yung BP. The doctor can order dopamine because that drug, dopamine, increases blood perfusion by increasing the blood pressure. So, depende po yun kung ano yung kailangan ng ating pasyente. Depending yun sa kailangan ng pasyente, yun din yung ibibigay natin na gamot. Kunwari, pagpangit yung quality of the heart rate, calcium chloride yung ibibigay because it increases heart contractility. Pag mababa yung BP, we can give dopamine because it increases blood perfusion by increasing the BP. Paano naman po kung yung kanyang heart rate mababa, BP mababa, anong pwede nating ibigay? We can give epinephrine because your epinephrine increases cardiac contractions. It also increases the heart rate. It also increases the BP. Okay. So, paano naman po yung pasyente natin ay meron siyang signs of respiratory acidosis? Okay. We can already give sodium bicarbonate. Yun po kasing sodium bicarbonate, it is alkalotic in nature. So, pag alkaline and then acid, binabalance po niya yan together. It improves the equilibrium of the pH in our body. So, pag yung pasyente po meron siyang metabolic acidosis or respiratory acidosis, we can already give sodium bicarbonate, which in nature is alkalotic. Aside from that, we can also give surfactants to our patient. The surfactants are administered in the endotracheal tube and it is sprayed on the endotracheal tube to prevent symptoms of respiratory distress. Again, depending po kung ano yung kailangan ng ating pasyente, yun po yung mga drugs na i-order ng ating physician. Now, after this video po, I will be attaching a video regarding neonatal resuscitation. So, please take a screenshot of the YouTube link that you see on your screen if you want to rewatch the video after our session together. So, again, I will be playing a video so that you will know and understand better how neonatal resuscitation is done.
So let's go through that resuscitation process. In the first step, we have initial stabilization. Then we engage in assessing the airway, the breathing, and the circulation. Just like adults, but it's a little bit different. Next, we may need to do chest compressions if that child is bradycardic. And lastly, we may need to administer epinephrine or volume expansion depending on the clinical circumstances. We'll go through that now. First, let's talk about the initial stabilization. The most important thing when a baby is handed off to the pediatrician is not the airway, it's maintaining the temperature and drying the baby. So the first thing we do before we do anything else is we vigorously dry the baby and place them under the warmer. We have to keep that baby warm and dry. The warmer is very useful because we don't need to keep the baby swaddled under the warmer, so we can engage in other activities such as the ABCs. It is often through just the drying process alone that a baby wakes up, starts crying, and looks much better, and our job is almost done. However, if the baby does not wake up or does not interact in a way that we expect, we may have to further investigate with airway breathing and circulation. It is important to keep the neck in a neutral or a slightly extended position, as the structures of the airway can themselves prevent adequate oxygenation and ventilation. The first thing we'll often do is suck out the nose and mouth with a bulb or a suction catheter. It's important then to check the circulation. The best place to feel a pulse on a baby is actually the umbilical stump. You can easily feel the pulse pulsating through that umbilical stump, and that's where you can check that heart rate. Oftentimes, if there are multiple practitioners, one will be doing the airway, the other will be tapping out the pulse on the table so that the airway operator can have a sense of what is that pulse. Now, here's what we do when things go wrong. If the patient has apnea, or the heart rate is less than 100, we're going to give some positive pressure ventilation. That's done through effective ventilation with a bag and mask. Remember, the baby's head should be a little bit back or a little bit forward. If they're crunched over like this, you won't necessarily be able to get the mask over it and fit it well. When you're giving these bags, you need to watch for chest rise. Without chest rise, you probably aren't doing it right. There may be a leak. Next, if the heart rate goes below 60, despite 30 seconds of positive pressure ventilation, the time has come to start chest compressions. And we're also going to administer oxygen. CPAP is effective often in helping a baby breathe. Usually what we can do is first we vigorously dry the baby. If they're still not breathing, we may just provide a little bit of CPAP. Most delivery rooms have a Mapleson bag. A Mapleson bag is that floppy one that requires an active air outlet from the wall. The advantage of the Mapleson bag is we can get a sense from it of how much CPAP we're providing, because we don't want to give too much CPAP, because then you could cause pulmonary problems. Generally around 5 is adequate. Next, we're going to intubate, especially if the bag mask is ineffective or the chest compressions are required. We will give epinephrine if the heart rate is remaining persistently below 60 to try and bring up that heart rate. Normal saline or blood transfusion may be indicated in a patient where there was excessive blood loss, for example, if the patient had placenta previa in utero. And we used to intubate for all meconium and suck out the meconium. That's really no longer recommended. Centers are just starting to come around to that. You may have learned in a center where they intubate for meconium, but the guidelines clearly say that's no longer necessary. Okay. One important aspect of the delivery room is being able to describe accurately how sick a baby is at the time of delivery. This invention was made by Virginia Apgar. Virginia Apgar was a famous physician who described a way of assessing babies, and the Apgar score, which is named after Virginia Apgar, is measured at 1, 5, and 10 minutes. Let's go through how we calculate the Apgar score. What's convenient is we can use the letters of Virginia Apgar's name as a reminder of what the 5 types of measurements are in the Apgar score. So the A stands for appearance. If a child is completely blue, they get 0 points. If they have just blue hands and feet, they get 1 point. And if they are completely pink, they get 2 points. In all the Apgar scores I've seen, this is the one I think that's the hardest to get 2 points on. Usually kids are a little bit blue in their extremities. The P in APGAR stands for pulse. If a patient has no pulse at all, they get 0 points. If their pulse is present but less than 100, they get 1 point, and if it's over 100, they get 2 points. The G stands for grimace, which is really just the response to stimulation. If you're stimulating them and they do nothing, they get 0 points. If they grimace and cry and fuss, they get 1 point. If they cough, sneeze, and vigorously cry and are present with you, that's 2 points. A stands for activity. If they're silent, 0 points, whimpering, 1 point, or crying, which we love, 2 points. R is for respiration. If they have no respiratory effort, 0, an irregular respiratory effort, 1, or regular effort, 2. This is something that takes a little bit of experience. The first few times you're in a delivery room, try to volunteer to do the APGAR score and see if the other practitioner agrees. Sometimes there is agreement, that's okay. This is just getting a rough idea of what is the patient's APGAR. Remember, 10 points is perfect. It's very rare that patients are a 10. So now we've done the APGAR score, we've resuscitated the baby. Let's say this baby is continuing to have problems with respiration. I wanted to talk about one of the most common causes of respiratory distress in a newborn baby, and that is transient tachypnea of the newborn. This usually goes away on its own within a day or so. So this is a really common problem in infants, and it's particularly common in infants who are a C-section. This is because the process of squeezing through that birth canal, which is so powerful that it deforms the child's head, is painful to that child, and it wakes them up, and it gets them going, and it also causes a stress response that allows these infants to breathe better. Without that stress response, if they're just pulled out of the uterus through C-section, they don't get the opportunity to clear out those lungs and breathe more comfortably. This is a failure of fetal alveolar fluid to clear the airway, which is mediated by a stress response. It results in a respiratory distress of an infant and usually resolves perfectly well within the first 24 hours of life. Sometimes these infants require supportive treatment in the neonatal intensive care unit. They may require CPAP or extra oxygen, but it would be rare for them to need a Frank intubation. So that's my review of neonatal resuscitation and the APGAR score and transient tachypnea of the newborn. Thanks for your time.
For your asynchronous activity for this week, you will be making a drug study of all 7 medications that are used during neonatal resuscitation. And your drug study should include the following details. Number 1 should be the name of the drug. Number 2 will be the dosage, the frequency, the timing, and the route of the drug. Aside from that, the mechanism action of the drug that you are studying, along with its indication, why it is given to our patients. The contraindications, the adverse effects, and your midwifery responsibilities. You have to upload your assignment using the file name, your surname, and then your name, and then drug study. And the deadline for submission will be on May 18, 2022. Again, this should be on your Word file. You should upload it via soft copy, and then we should upload it in your Google Classroom. So yun po yung magiging assignment natin, and it is also going to be used to check your attendance for this week.